Cloud. Okay, now we can start the recording. And today, the topic, according to the program, is the learning experience. Now, the Padova Model UPR as a learning experience, basically. And again, the floor is to Leah Rea.
Thank you so much, Professor. I am just going to share my screen. And I hope this works. We sometimes do have technical issues. And can I just confirm that you can see my screen? Perfect. Thank you very much. So good afternoon and welcome to the next episode of this webinar series, where today, as the professor has said, we will be exploring essentially the learning experience of our participants who are involved in the Padova Model UPR. And again, just a reminder for anyone who is viewing this recording and seeing the slides that the application process is open for our sixth edition, and the deadline is the 6th of October. So you can apply online as your team and submit your applications. And as ever, if you have any questions or queries about the process, about the project itself, what's involved, please do contact the SHEAR Secretariat. The email address is on the slides and they will be very happy to help. So today, as ever, I have split this webinar into two parts. And the first part is looking at participant learning as aims and objectives. And for us, it's structured this way because as part of engaging in the Padova Model UPR, it's expected that our participants who are students will have their skill set and their abilities continuously enhanced and engaged throughout the duration of all the stages of the project, and not just the simulation days, but they will be actively evaluated on the application of their knowledge and understanding of their roles and how to conduct themselves during that process during the simulation itself. So we will look at what are the aims and objectives of participant learning, and then very importantly, how are these conveyed to participants? We, as I alluded to in the previous webinar, we very much run this project as being learner focused and student focused. So for us and for me personally, throughout my time involved in the Padova Model UPR, it's very important that participants are actively aware of how they will be enhancing their skill sets, enhancing their understanding and knowledge, how that's evaluated and tested during the project, and then subsequently for them to be able to reflect on what they have learned and how they can apply this, particularly in a professional environment after their studies. And then that brings us to the idea of employability and transferable skills provision, which again, because our participants are students, is so crucial and so relevant for them as they progress into professional employment. And then the second part is probably a bit more practical, looking at what I mean by participant evaluation, how it's conducted and what students can learn from this. And also for the practical idea of this, how the Secretariat can design for participant evaluation and convey the outcome of that evaluation to participants as teams, so they can apply the feedback and the comments and suggestions that are made to them as part of the evaluation process as active learners post their time with us in the Padova Model UPR. But firstly, just a reminder for anyone who may be aware of the first webinar I had the opportunity to deliver, sort of reflecting on what the actual aims and objectives are of our project and how this connects to student learning. So in my first webinar, I talked about the project really aims to increase knowledge and understanding of the international human rights system, multilateral diplomacy, institutionalism, the international system of rights monitoring and rights compliance, and the understanding of the UPR process as a mechanism specifically, and equally trying to enhance participants' understanding of what we mean by rights monitoring and rights compliance. And in so doing, we have that contemporary application of knowledge and understanding, encouraging our participants to understand realpolitik, geopolitics, international relations, positioning their knowledge and understanding within contemporary human rights sphere. And then also the more practical skill sets of research capacity and capabilities, teamwork and engagement. And then also just that sense of facilitating and enhancing international community and relationship building. So bearing that in mind, what are the benefits to participants? Again, as a refresher, that development of knowledge and understanding of the UPR as a mechanism specifically, but that wider body of international human rights as a system, monitoring compliance and so on. And giving participants the opportunity to adopt those roles, as we know, states, INGOs and NHRIs throughout their time in the simulation to understand how each component works within the wider UPR procedure. And then subsequently for them to have the experience to gain the understanding of what we mean by assessing state records, their compliance, but equally when it's clear they're a violation of human rights. So how does that tie in to participant learning? For me, it's always important to reconsider what we're hoping to gain with running the project entire, so we can understand what we want students to come away with in terms of their learning base. So for me, these are what I consider the aims of our participant learning throughout their time with us on the project. Firstly, that sense of the practical skills-based learning. And I think this is really important because over time, many of our participants are students of human rights, students of politics, international relations and law. And they will have very strong experience in the theoretical and conceptual concepts of those fields, and quite maybe don't have the opportunity yet to apply that knowledge as theory into practice. And this simulation provides the opportunity for them to learn to do just that, which is really important if they hope to pursue a career in a relevant field associated with the fields that we cover in the Padova Model UPR, being based on, of course, the UPR process itself. And I think it's important to emphasize the skill-based learning, because many skill sets, as I will cover through this presentation, are invoked and enhanced throughout every stage of preparation and conducting the simulation. That sense of the clear and comprehensive conveying and dissemination of information in both written and oral form is equally very important as a learning aim for participants. Many of our participants, again, will have a very strong academic background in those relevant fields, but it's about understanding how they can practically convey knowledge and understanding in a way that's actually more applicable to the professional environment, more so than just within the academic structure within academic institutions, such as for their exams. And then building upon that, the application of their already existing theoretical and conceptual knowledge within that simulation setting. Again, it's getting that balance between what they will learn as part of their degree studies, what they will learn and discuss about within their classroom setting, but we apply it in a quasi-professional simulation environment in which they are adopting roles and they must act as though they hold those real life positions, and seeing then for them how they can bring the theory and the practice to life and to combine them in doing so. Equally very important is really conveying to participants around teamwork, project management, self-directed research and application. And this is something we try to convey to our participants right from the outset, that importance of self-directedness, whether that's time management or undertaking your research and preparing the papers that arise from that research. The Padova Model UPR is an intensive process. It's a very stimulating process, and it really relies heavily on participants themselves being able to direct themselves and their teams. And that's a really core important skill that they will need to bring into their professional environment upon the conclusion of their studies. And this provides them an opportunity to learn how to do that and to be supported in learning how to do that. And then finally, tying in with what are our ultimate aims and objectives of the project itself, the practical learning as a learning aim for our students around the international human rights system, that sense of geopolitics, international relations, which obviously at the minute, given various issues and events unfolding in Europe and beyond, is very relevant in a contemporary learning environment. And again, really ties in with that sense of applying existing knowledge and understanding into a much more practical skill set simulation setting. So what are our objectives? And for me, I've tried to think of how I would try to summarize this, because I actually think there are a number of objectives of our participant learning, but these are the most fundamental points, I think, and they should tie in neatly, if this were to be a module that is studied, tying into a broader degree pathway and professional employment context. So participants ultimately should be able to demonstrate and to enhance their written and oral communication skills. And I've also stressed there, especially within a professional setting. And this is because, as I've outlined in previous webinars, when it comes to the simulation setting itself, participants, because they are assuming those adopted roles, they will be acting as state delegates. They will be acting as NHRI or INGO representatives. They have to conduct themselves in a professional, diplomatic manner and use the appropriate formal language, tone, etc. So it's not just simply about being able to present a beautifully written and researched report. It's also about being able to communicate that in an oral form that's suitable for a professional setting. Then secondly, to be able to develop their persuasive writing skills and their negotiation skills, as well as their persuasive speaking skills. And there are a number of opportunities for participants to be able to learn how to actually conduct them, their writing and their speaking in a persuasive manner, whether it's through their oral contributions in the pre-session stage of the simulation, to the all-important lobbying aspect of the simulation, and then at the close with item 6, our participants will have the opportunity to firstly be persuasive in how they convey the position of their adopted role, but equally how they can engage with other teams, how they can engage in alliance building, how they can conduct themselves with lobbying to try to achieve their stated goals. And also what's very important to this, as I will allude later on in the presentation, we give participants themselves the opportunity to plan how they will be persuasive and how then they can evaluate how effective they feel their lobbying efforts were in that sense of being persuasive. And that also offers a really good reflective learning process for our participants. As I'd said previously, about the idea of self-directed research and preparation, I think that's a really important objective. And again, it ties in very strongly with their current academic studies, but equally with the sense of what they will have to bring to the workplace upon the close of their studies. Equally, being able to demonstrate project and team management. This is conveyed very clearly right from the application process about the importance of working as a unit, coordinating work, coordinating time and presence, and communicating with their team as well as with other teams. And again, these are really important core skills that students can engage and enhance and then utilize after their time with us in the project. I've also included adaptability, adapting to different professional settings. And again, this is because our participants will move from formal presentations to lobbying, which they themselves will set up and conduct, back to formal and written contributions. So there's a lot of change in how participants will communicate and in what way they will communicate. So adaptability is really important, and it's something that's quite clearly demonstrated through their time on the project. And then lastly, just to stipulate, cultural awareness is very important, particularly because many of our teams will be representing, if they're occupying roles of states, countries which they may actually never have visited. They may have had to research very in depth about their country. And this gives them an opportunity to demonstrate cultural sensitivity and cultural awareness as a learning process. And then just that sense, again, to emphasize working within timeframes and deadlines. It's a very intensive process, and participants essentially must work as a team, as I said before, to ensure they meet their deadlines. and that they plan accordingly around the lobbying aspect, for example, and then creating their evaluation scheme to ensure that they have a really enjoyable experience, a stimulating experience, and something which is not a pressurized environment as well. And how are all those aims and objectives conveyed to participants? What they will learn and how they're expected to learn is always very clearly conveyed and at every element of the program. And I have some examples here just to demonstrate this. So as I had spoken about in a previous week around how the application form, for example, is designed and structured, the application form is the participant's first opportunity to engage with the simulation. And the manner in which the form is designed conveys that the focus will be on existing competencies to demonstrate how those competencies will be engaged and will be enhanced throughout the time in the project, as well as inquiring after participants' existing knowledge and understanding, whether that's the UPR specifically, broader rights issues in their preferred state role, or how an NHRI, for example, entails its work within the UPR mechanism. The questions that are within the application form should very clearly convey to the students that these skills, these areas of focus, will be pertinent throughout the simulation, which therefore means their existing abilities will be utilised and will be enhanced throughout the simulation. The Padova Model UPR handbook also very clearly, through covering each stage of the simulation, will demonstrate the skill set that will be utilised at each stage. And it's again one of the reasons why we constantly refer back to the handbook to our participants, particularly with regards to the delivery of the training programme, so that the participants are aware of, firstly, what's, you know, what they have to do and how that's required of them, but also how they can enhance their performance and how they can learn as they do so, so that they can maybe apply feedback and comments and suggestions to their work for the future. And then lastly, it's very much the focus of the training programme that we constantly convey to participants how they will gain knowledge and understanding and how they will enhance their skill sets through their time in the simulation, particularly because we give that overview of the assessments, both written and oral. And we then also try to explain in a less formal manner to our participants how the secretariat will mark them, how their performances at each stage of the simulation on site will be evaluated. And the reason why I say we try to say it in a less formal way is because to date we don't provide marking rubric to our participants. And I'll cover this in my final slide when I talk about reflections and possible developments in the project. But I suppose at the minute it's felt that to provide participants with marking rubric, it can seem a bit daunting. And also with the training programme, it might seem like it's not quite connected to provide marking rubric when participants are still learning about the programme, learning about what's expected of them, and learning about each relevant assessment component, particularly when it comes to lobbying. To be given an Excel sheet and be given a description of evaluation as it currently is drafted might seem daunting and might cause information overload. So what we do instead within training is we talk about how participants will be marked for their manner of speaking, and we essentially use more accessible language when we convey this. So as I said, I'll speak more to that at the end of this presentation, but that's our current way of working in the training programme. And that's just to show you how we do that. So for example, this is taken from an NHRI training session delivered last year, where we convey what each stage of simulation looks like and what will be expected of the participants holding that role based on what their role would actually do in the UPR mechanism itself. And then for the last part of part one, what do we mean by employability and transferable skills? Trying to convey to participants that the skills they use in their time as participants in the Padova Model UPR can be applied within their professional employment, be that volunteering or an internship as they're still at university, or when they move into the professional environment subsequent to their time at university, it's trying to ensure participants understand that this experience is something they can discuss, whether it's part of an application process or an interview process. We really want to convey, and I think this is something we can do a bit more at the minute, convey to participants this is an ongoing learning opportunity, and what they have learnt and what they've gained in the Padova Model UPR shouldn't just finish or be forgotten about when they receive their participation certificate at the end of the simulation. It's trying to get participants to understand that the skills they've learnt are transferable, and how they can also convey this in their CVs, within their resumes, and incorporating their experience, their roles, and specific tasks they undertook and what they learned from that within environments like interview settings. And I have there the Padova Model UPR as itself being a work experience. I very much believe that given the duration participants are with us from and the different tasks they are required to undertake, the manner that they have to work as teams, the assessments they must complete, all basically relates to their time in the simulation being a work experience project in itself. And I think if participants start to think about the project as work experience, they'll not only realise that it can be fun, it can be enjoyable, and they are making friends and they're learning, but also this is something that they can take away and apply to future settings. So I think a very important point, both to convey to participants, but for us also to think about, is how do we ensure what I've called the carryover of that experience for participants into future projects, into future employment, or possibly also into future academic study. Then with regards to part two, so last week I had said evaluation in the Padova Model UPR is twofold. And last week we looked at self-evaluation in terms of the Secretariat understanding how to evaluate, redesign, reconfigure the model for each edition following on from participant feedback. For me, this week is looking at how participant evaluation is really forefront in delivering the simulation as a learner-centered approach. There are several ways and means of how participants are evaluated through the different elements of the model project. And I've written a quick synopsis there, but I'll look into more detail in a few slides, but it's everything from formal presentation and written contributions and submissions to the written submissions, and then also the lobbying component, and then concluding remarks at item six. And for me, that demonstrates as part of this, you know, the Padova Model UPR is absolutely a learning experience. It is also a game. It's a chance for a simulation role play where participants can then vote for who they think was the most successful team at the close of the simulation. But it also means within the context of participant evaluation in the broader sense of learning, the learning experience, we have the role of marking in both. And marking is not just something for me, which is about scoring and then having a score and assigning a score to a team. It's broader than that. It should be about feedback. It should be conveying strengths, areas of growth, for reflection of participants, so they can understand where they can improve and how then that can relate to either their current academic studies or their future employment experience. So I'll just change the layout of my screen here because at the minute my slides are broken. There we go. Evaluation is once more led on by the Secretariat. The Secretariat has the responsibility for assessing participants for both the written and oral contributions and assessments. And it's conducted through what I've termed a peer review marking system. So we will have two assessors per team for oral and written contributions. And I want to emphasize a point here about the role of and the importance of three elements of that, because for me, this is a learning experience, not just for participants themselves. It's a learning experience for the Secretariat because they themselves are engaging in new skills and enhancing existing skills, particularly through the evaluation of other students. And I'll touch on this later, but for me, what's a very much a clear takeaway as a learning experience for the Secretariat are these 3 points: understanding the importance of self-organization and coordination by designing a rota to conduct the evaluation of participants. This is to ensure that the assessment is being conducted in a timely manner. And that's really important because whilst for the written assignments, you can take time to read and read over and maybe read over again an NHRI report, for example, when it comes to the spoken contributions, particularly on the day one, which is the pre-session, where teams will have 5 minutes to speak, that's the only opportunity you will have as an evaluator to hear that contribution and to mark it accordingly. So the rota is very important to ensure timeliness, to ensure that you have a team in place, that if for whatever reason someone has to then drop out, there is a replacement on standby. Because otherwise it will do a disservice to the overall design and structure of the project not to have fair evaluation, but it does a disservice to the participants themselves because they may not get the full time in terms of the Secretariat having the proper amount of time to listen to their contribution and to mark it accordingly. So the rota is really, really important. I have there also team design, and that's because I think when we work as the peer review system to assessors per team, we need to ensure that the 2 members of the Secretariat who are leading, so you should have at least 6, 2 for states, 2 for NGOs, 2 for NHRIs. What traditionally happens within the Secretariat is because the Secretariat is comprised of usually past participants of the Padova Model UPR, they will volunteer to be the evaluators of the role that they themselves occupied. So for myself, for example, I previously had served in an NHRI team. So I was the lead evaluator for NHRIs in my time in the Secretariat in 2022. And that's because I was considered one of the ones best placed, having occupied the role myself, to know how to mark the teams accordingly in my year. It doesn't make sense to mix people up, so to speak, in that way. And it's also particularly important when it comes to states, because the experience of state teams is quite different to NHRIs and INGOs. And it's really important that you have at least 2 people in place who know that pathway very clearly, so they know what it is to look for in terms of best practice when it comes to marking. And then finally, the idea of deadlines covers similar ground to the first point of the rota. It's very important, just as we emphasize a sense of the learning experience with time management, project management, timekeeping for participants, we equally emphasize that for the Secretariat. There is a learning experience for Secretariat members in terms of time management when it comes to when and how they undertake the evaluations and the reviews. So last year, for example, we checked in and we gave each other timeframes for when we wanted the first round of review for written assignments, for example, to be completed. So the second assessor could go and complete their work. There was then a timeframe for the second assessor to do that, and so on. It just means there's a chance to ensure that there's discussion among both reviewers around marks, particularly if perhaps there could be issues like plagiarism, or there could be some discrepancies around the evaluator's interpretation of certain points. And again, we don't want to do a disservice to participants. Their work should not be marked in a rushed manner, which therefore means something could be overlooked, because it's their learning experience fundamentally, and it's really important that their work is given time to be judged accordingly. And then I'll just briefly say that the process really entails a collation of marks and comments, which are then subsequently held in a database. We have template documents for this. Marks are calculated per assessment, and then there is a cumulative score for the teams. And all this is undertaken in accordance with what will be a Secretariat-wide agreed upon evaluation criteria. And it's essentially a scoring system through a rubric where it's a scale of 1 to 5, 5 being the highest number of points. And there's also room for penalisation, particularly when it comes to timekeeping or going over the word count, but also for plagiarism as well, because this ultimately is also an academic simulation. So trying to convey the importance of avoiding plagiarism and to have self-directed research with reports written in your own words and so on to participants. That's very important. And there's very much a theme to all my webinars where I talk about reviewing, reflecting, and redesign. In the context of evaluation criteria for the Secretariat, we have that reflective process again as part of their own learning experience, reviewing and revisiting existing evaluation criteria, the design of the evaluation forms, the very process of how evaluation is conducted and how information is stored. That should be conducted probably around late spring through the summer of the Secretariat's tenure or for their respective edition, with the possibility of redesign both the criteria and the forms if that's felt to be required. And again, in that process of confirming teams, there should be some sort of internal review mechanism for the Secretariat members to identify their own skill sets, what roles they themselves held, and form teams around that. And also, I think it's really important to ensure that this is conducted, like I said, in the summer, so that those who will be leading on the evaluation component for the simulation in November are confident themselves in actually applying the evaluation criteria to participants. Like I said, this is a learning experience for Secretariat members as well, and many Secretariat members will not have undertaken something like this before. And whilst that means they will be really gaining great skills that they can apply for the future, it also means that for some, they might be a bit apprehensive because it's quite new and original. So I can talk about this at the close of my presentation. I think there's a lot of work, or rather there's scope to be done about ensuring that the Secretariat themselves feel that they're trained and they're prepared to undertake evaluation. And then have the opportunity for themselves to reflect on their learning as they do so. And I've already covered those other points. So just to simply confirm that the process about inputting data, having information stored securely, and the reviewing of each response independently. There is a tendency when there's a two-person system of marking for the second reviewer to go straight to look at the comments and the marks allocated by the first reviewer. And where possible, that should be prevented because that can lead to a marking bias. The second reviewer should look at their copy of the assessment before them without, you know, as it is, without looking at what their colleague has already scored and the comments they've given, just to ensure that they're not going to be maybe swayed by their colleague's comments. They have to mark it on their own basis before we have a comparison of marks and comments. And this should just give an indication of the work that's involved for the Secretariat, but also how we ensure that it's a process which means evaluation will be a very beneficial exercise for participants in terms of their own learning processes. So this is just a screenshot from our infamous shared drive on Google. This is taken from the 2022 Secretariat's drive. So you can see the various folders that connect to those stages I've identified previously about the written submissions, the oral submissions, the lobbying evaluations. So it's an intensive process for the Secretariat. It's a learning experience for Secretariat members, picking up those skills, the raw skills, and enhancing them of marking, of they themselves being able to convey information in a succinct way, of understanding how to apply criteria, which ultimately ensures that our participants will have the opportunity to learn from this evaluation, to learn from the assessment in a way that can enhance their existing skill sets for application into the future. So when and how is evaluation conducted? I'll build upon what I've previously said. There are really five key stages, and within these stages, for some of them, the contributions or the assessments are of both oral and written communications. The very first aspect of evaluation to facilitate the learning experience for our participants starts with the submission of the respective written assessments for each role for what would be the part before the pre-session of the simulation. So for states, that will be their submission of their national reports. For NHRIs and INGOs, it'll be the submission of their written report. So NHRIs, the written report for their identified state, and INGOs on certain thematic areas that they've agreed are their focus in line with what that organisation would have traditionally do within the UPR mechanism. So that's the very first assessment. It's also a written assessment. And as I said before, that means there's some time for the evaluation to be conducted by secretariat members. And it also means then, in terms of the learning experience for participants, this will be very much focused on self-directed research, communicating information, persuasive writing, and also very fundamentally, deadlines and word counts. We traditionally have at least one team annually who will go over the word count and one team who will go under the word count. I'm going to see if that tradition holds up at the end of this year. But it's just a good opportunity to even evaluate how participants stick to rules and how to convey to them the importance of adhering to guidelines as well as part of the learning experience. The second aspect pertains to their pre-session presentation. And this will be a presentation that really builds upon the information that has been submitted in the written assessment. This will be an oral assessment, so therefore the evaluation criteria is different slightly, and how it is applied is slightly different. It also is a challenge for both participants and the secretariat members. For the secretariat members, as I alluded to previously, it's having to evaluate within quite a tight time frame and not having the chance really to see the contribution once more. For those delivering the pre-session presentations, it means they have to really engage their oral communication and how that's conveyed as a persuasive manner of speaking. But then we also go back to that importance of professional tone, language, and conduct, and the diplomatic language that is used. In terms of the third component, this is really much more pertaining to states, more so than NHRIs and INGOs. We have the working group sessions and the operation of Troika. And this is something that I think we could work on in terms of conveying the importance of this as a learning experience to participants occupying these roles. The fourth stage is the infamous lobbying stage. This pertains both written and oral evaluation. It's written and oral because not only would participants be expected, obviously, to engage in the spoken lobbying aspect, but as I have said previously, this offers a really unique reflection for participants to learn from their own experiences and apply that new knowledge to future experiences, because they have to design their own lobbying plan and then subsequently design their own evaluation plan of how they thought their lobbying worked. So it's a good compare and contrast exercise, which is also marked. And then lastly, we have the item six, which again has both a written and oral aspect for teams to submit their concluding remarks and then deliver their concluding remarks. And again, traditionally, we usually have at least one team not quite understand what we mean by concluding remarks and or delivering something more as a lobbying aspect and then having to change what they actually deliver. So the marks that they have submitted in written form don't quite align with their oral form. So we'll see how that works out in November as well. But that's the final opportunity for evaluation and equally seeing how participants stick to the guidelines for time and for the diplomatic tone and language and conduct I had spoken about previously. And I said at the start of this presentation how we really convey the learning opportunities, the experience and the skill sets through a training program. And again, this is a slide taken from a training session delivered in 2022, where we don't just remind participants of the key dates. We're trying to also remind them, firstly, as you can see, that sense of the time management and the project management that's involved and how the skills needed to do that can be applied, the role of teamwork and also self-directed study. So when we remind them of their assignments, we're not just giving them dates, we're emphasizing what's required for them to meet those dates and deadlines, but we're also giving another opportunity to discuss what is involved, what they should learn from it and to give them the chance to ask questions so they can also have an ongoing learning process. Because again, this is ultimately a participant-led project. It's a learner-centered approach that we apply. And these are just quickly showing you, when I talk about those templates for evaluation that would be utilized by the Secretariat, might be revised and redesigned accordingly for each subsequent edition. But this is very important, and I will touch on the specific criteria as part of this marking rubric in a minute. But when I had said previously, at the minute, this isn't shared with participants because it might look a bit daunting. This is probably why. When you just see an Excel sheet that says, you know, a key criteria and a short explanation of that criteria, whilst you're also receiving training for the assessments, it might seem a bit daunting. So we could consider how to redesign this, I don't know. But fundamentally, we work around four key criteria: content, authenticity, public speaking skills, and structure. So we're really looking at all those key skills I had identified previously. But what you will see is this template looks at firstly the oral contributions for those four criteria, and then the written contributions. So the criteria will stay the same. How they're applied, I said this earlier, that the application of criteria can differ between written and oral contributions, and I will show you this subsequently. The criteria stay the same, but how they applied are different. So, for example, when we look at content and display of knowledge, for example, how that is applied in oral format, but when it comes to persuasiveness, will be different from how it's applied in written format. And that's a really important distinction, as an example, for both the Secretariat conducting this evaluation to understand, and for participants themselves to understand. And for us, I think it's an ongoing discussion about how do we more clearly convey the criteria generally, but also how to understand them in a way that firstly doesn't sound so formal, that could be daunting language, but understanding how they can be met, if that makes sense. I think that's very much an ongoing discussion to be had. And that gives you an example of how the sliding scale can be applied, but I want to go into the criteria themselves. So these are slightly redrafted each year, but they've never been, as far as I'm aware, quite substantially discussed. So firstly, we look at content. And for us, that's that display of understanding and knowledge. And we list some aspects of that being human rights issues generally, the progress made by states, the role of the NHRI, the effectiveness of the NHRI with the state's progress, and general UPR engagement. So the history that maybe the state has of the UPR mechanism or the NHRI and the NGO. We also look at relevancy. And this is the opportunity for participants to show their understanding of contemporary human rights contexts or international relation contexts I'd spoken about previously as a skill set. Also then factual accuracy, quality, and clarity of recommendations. That's particularly important, whether it's at the very start of the simulation or in the lobbying aspect or at the close of the simulation. There's a lot obviously there, and I think again it ties into my final slide about how we understand these and how we apply these both as Secretariat members with evaluation in order to ensure participants are aware what we mean by this and what skills are engaged by this. But it then ties very neatly into the second criteria, which is authenticity. So this is essentially how effective participants are in occupying the role that they have been assigned and how they immerse themselves into the experience. So it's role play, adoptive positioning, demonstrating the understanding and knowledge of that, awareness, understanding of strategic relations, interaction with the other teams based on their research of knowing what their role previously and historically has done by way of interaction, and then the importance of the diplomatic language and tone and content. And this is a really interesting criteria, and it's something we emphasize to participants every year. And sometimes I think there's a struggle with what we mean by this. Participants traditionally think that they can maybe just put in some formal language, and that's authenticity. And we're trying to really get them to understand that they have to do their research and their identify role and really assume the role and know what it means when it's said, you know, when they say certain words or they use certain aspects of language, what that means. And I think that's an ongoing aspect of how we convey what we mean by that. The third criteria pertains to public speaking. And I'll not spend too much time on this, but it comes back to that point I made about the skill set of adaptability, persuasiveness. And we have spontaneity, and that's really important when it comes to lobbying, but also within the working groups and the Troika sessions. And participants who work really hard with authenticity normally demonstrate spontaneity very effectively because they're confident that they know what their role how the role would act or convey themselves and their position in the real life UPR mechanism. Timing and active engagement are equally as important. We always try to demonstrate to participants the importance of timekeeping and how that pertains to the real world and not just necessarily the UPR mechanism itself, because participants will be cut off if they go over time, and that can obviously then undermine their performance and that of their team overall. And active engagement, again, we try to convey the importance of understanding that this is a live project, so to speak. So particularly when it comes to lobbying, not just entering the room, saying what they have prepared, sitting back and thinking that that's lobbying. It's thinking on your feet, it's adapting to the circumstances and constantly engaging in dialogue in a diplomatic, negotiable manner with the other actors before you. And then finally, structure, which I think covers the previous three criteria as well in its own way. So we're looking at, again, relevancy, but persuasiveness, coherence, and that ties into one of the objectives I identified at the start of this presentation. How do you clearly and comprehensively convey information, your position, your recommendations, and in written and oral form? And that's so, so, so important, because sometimes our participants do a phenomenal amount of research. I mean, their research is outstanding and they have prepared a beautiful report, but they can't convey it in oral format, or it's the other way around. The written report might not be as strong, but they have outstanding oral coherence. So we're trying to convey the coherence. It's not just one or the other, it's across both, but it's slightly different in each regard. And it's very important that participants have the chance to understand that, because that's something that they can learn, can apply then in professional contexts at the close of their studies. So then, I've said about my final slide is always the sense of reflections on our existing practice and understanding best practice and how we can proceed. I think the first point for me is looking at the timing of evaluation by the Secretariat. I had said that timekeeping for the Secretariat is in itself a learning experience for members, but it's understanding that whilst we will always say to participants, this is an intensive process and it will be challenging, but it's a reason it's modeled on the real UPR and the skill set you will acquire by sticking to time. Equally, that's the same. It's an intensive process for the Secretariat, and that's why I spoke about the need to have a rota, the need to think about designing the teams who are conducting the evaluation, and the need to ensure you have clearly identified timeframes and deadlines for the undertaking of the review of written assessments and oral assessments. This is so important because it can be easy to become overwhelmed with marking. But like I said, I'm going to emphasize it again, because we have that learner-centered approach. We do not want to do our participants a disservice. This is their learning opportunity. And if evaluation is not organized in a way by the Secretariat members that it may end up being, if they can't, you know, they might miss a part of an oral contribution and therefore they can't fully mark it, that does a disservice for participants in terms of their own learning opportunities. Or if feedback is not provided, or feedback, if it is provided, is very limited. We want participants to be able to take what they have learned and apply it going forward in their life. Like I said in one of my first slides, you know, how do we ensure that they understand this is something they can carry over, that their learning experience does not stop when they get their certificate? It's how they apply what they have learned. So this to me all comes back to the actual organization of the evaluation and understanding the importance of time. And I think tied into that could be how do we factor in the opportunity for the secretariat themselves to be trained for evaluation and how it's conducted, and then how do we time for that? I think going forward, it might be really worthwhile to have a workshop for the secretariat just around how to mark. We did have some issues last year where there wasn't agreement on marks across the member. I said there's the team, so it's peer review, two evaluator system. And if there's a dispute about the marks, that takes time to resolve, that could take away from marking someone else's report. So it's really important that we have a discussion. And whilst we do have external evaluators, our guest speakers or members of staff in the Human Rights Centre will also, particularly when it comes to the oral contributions, provide their feedback, provide their marks. It does come down to the secretariat having a great position as well. I've then talked about the scheduling of release of marks or feedback. At the moment, because of how the simulation timeframe is structured, marks or feedback aren't provided to participants during the simulation. Instead, they receive that cumulative score and feedback at the close of the simulation. So they will have the opportunity to be told about different components or their scores for different components. And for me, I wonder if perhaps there's feasibility to at least trial that idea of releasing marks and feedback after each assignment, perhaps just to give the teams an indication of their performance, and then they can learn from that. So what, based on their marks or feedback, are they doing well? Where could they improve? That could ultimately mean by the close of their time with us, the close of the simulation, they could have improved, for example, in their oral contributions. And that may mean a more productive learning experience for them. But then equally, how do we balance that with what's already an intensive schedule for both the participants and secretariat members? But I think it's something worthwhile to consider. And then that idea of the provision of written feedback. Sometimes feedback can be given in oral form or informally on site at the close of simulation from the secretariat members who are evaluating. At the minute, it's not a finalized process. It changes every year effectively how feedback is provided. So I think firstly we need to have a structured, finalized manner of how that's delivered and designed, but also ensuring that feedback is not just simply you were an excellent team, you did a great job. You know, it should be tied to the evaluation criteria and making clear the highest scoring part of the team's performance, lowest scoring part, and some suggestions for how that can be improved upon, so that this is a really productive, beneficial learning experience for participants. I said I would touch on this, that idea of, do we disseminate the marking scheme, evaluation criteria, the rubric, to participants? I think it might be worthwhile in the context of the general handbook revision discussion we are having in the Human Rights Centre, this idea of how do we incorporate what the marking rubric would look like in the handbook, because then it might give the opportunity for participants to read about it in their own time, so it doesn't perhaps feel so daunting to have it introduced in a training programme. And also then that can give space to the training programme for questions about the marking rubric. Equally, we could talk about how do we provide mock examples of work to demonstrate maybe a good national report versus a weaker national report, for example. It comes down to, I think getting that balance between really preparing participants to the best of our ability so they have as a productive time as possible versus not wanting to take away what I feel is a really important pillar of the self-directed study and self-directed research aspect for the participants. But I think we could maybe consider how do we use the handbook as a way of conveying to participants how they're going to be assessed, because the minute we talk about the components of assessment, written and oral, and I think if we could perhaps consider how do we expand on that to convey what we're actually looking for based on those criteria I spoke about earlier, I think it could help really convey the process and make it clear for for participants. And then I've talked here about that learner participant-centered approach. And it ties into the slide I had spoken to about transferable skills and employability. How can we convey to participants that this is not just something they can do in their degree and it sits there in their CV? It's how do they apply the skills they've either acquired? Some of our participants, you know, within their teams start this process where they would say they're not confident public speakers, for example, and at the close of the process, maybe they've led their team on lobbying. And that's a phenomenal development, personal development. How do we ensure that that's continued? So how do we carry over the experience? And I think for me, you know, as a reflection, there's something worthwhile about where it's possible to have some type of online employability workshop for those participants who would be interested. I don't know whether it should be compulsory or not, but something to really help them understand they have undertaken a learning experience. It's a, you know, a quasi work experience situation, understanding the skills they've acquired that they have put into practice, how they can describe what they've undertaken in a way that could be listed on a CV or a resume, how they can talk about that in an interview setting. So they realize the worth really of having been a participant, that not only was it enjoyable, it was something that was conducted outside the classroom. The fun of being able to have role play and a simulation, but also understanding that every bit that they did, particularly if they found it enjoyable, was active learning and active application of skills. And I think having a workshop focused around that can really help, you know, connect those experiences and frame it in a way for participants to understand that this is something that's valuable for their personal development and can be applied, like I said, in professional context, whether that's employment or a subsequent internship, or if they wanted to pursue further academic studies, they can convey how they've already practically looked at what the UPR looks like within this model format. Of course, that then comes with the time challenges, as I say, but just based on the sense of where can we go and what can we expand on the direction of the model UPR for our participants. That for me was just something I had identified. So I'll just close by saying, I know it says Thursday, but the next and final webinar of the series will take place on Monday, the 24th of July, looking at how we design and deliver the training program I have spoken about across these webinars. And then I'll close just by saying thank you very much for listening, and I'm happy to take any questions.
Thank you, Leah. Well, Sabaita, do you have questions?
First of all, thank you very much. This was really informing, and I think it was needed, especially the last part. I really found your idea very interesting. I think it could be useful not only for the participants, but also for us, for the members of the secretariat as ex-participants, and understanding the real value and how we can further use this. I have just one small comment about your possible idea of having evaluation after each of the tasks is completed. I have just one small doubt that some people that maybe have not been involved in such an activity before and have not been faced with having this sort of evaluation outside of their school, outside of academic studies, maybe it might be a bit discouraging if they receive negative feedback in during the simulation. Maybe for some people it could be stimulating, or for the people that get a positive feedback, it could be encouraging. But I just have this doubt that maybe it can set some teams back. This is just to be discussed. Maybe we can find a way to do it, you know, that it doesn't break the people's spirit. Like, I think it can be done, but this is just a small doubt for maybe people that are a bit more sensitive.
I also have a comment about this point, Leah, before you maybe give your opinion. My point is that instead of receiving an explicit feedback from the secretariat or, you know, facilitators and so on, I think it's more, let's say, convenient to encourage people to, you know, watch around to see what is the impact of what they, of their performance, what they just said, etc. This is a way to receive the signals directly from the other participants of the game, and learn how to, you know, interpret also the non-spoken language, you know, the body language in situations like this. But this is something that you have to learn if you want to participate in negotiations, diplomatic issues, and so on. So instead of make explicit, you know, what we think about their performance, I think it's a better service to the participants from our side to encourage them to, you know, learn from the, you know, the implicit feedback that they receive from the audience, in a sense. And then, of course, at the end of the game, we can be more explicit. We can make reference to this or that, you know, fact or statement or, you know, response they gave to the questions to highlight, you know, the best, the worst reactions, etc. But I think that a certain level of spontaneity and, you know, participate immersion, you know, in the flow of the game is more useful at the end, you know, for the learning purpose that we have in mind. Another small comment I want to make is that eventually all participants and also members of the secretariat in this exercise will receive from the University of Padova a so-called open badge, which is this stuff. I think you can see my screen on, so in international negotiation, which is the most, you know, appropriate description of the activities that we carry out, that we could find in the menu, you know, in the bouquet of open badges available in our university. So this is a description that, of course, was not explicitly carved having in mind our program, our model, but still captures some of the outcomes, no? Learning outcomes that Leah explained. So this maybe can also be mentioned to the participants. This is a sort of formalization of the learning experience that they can acquire, not participating in this event. And I think it's something that they can be proud of at the end. Yeah, that's it.
I just think that point about the act of learning you can undertake by watching others, you know, body language in response to what you say is so important. And I know that whenever the Padova Model UPR was conducted online because of the COVID pandemic for a number of years, I was someone who participated virtually. You know, I participated in 2021, and I feel that was something that, you know, unfortunately couldn't be conveyed through Zoom. And I think the on-site component allows for that. And it in itself is such a good, like, timely feedback, especially from the other teams. And I think particularly when it's the lobbying component as well. So absolutely. And I think there's something to be said perhaps about how we can communicate that to participants, that it's not just about speaking to the secretariat who are adopting the role of president, you know, it's also looking around the room and interacting in that way. And I think sometimes participants, particularly in the very first day, because, you know, there's slight nerves at undertaking their roles, very much treat it like a school day. So they'll turn up and they'll look only at the secretariat members on site, yeah, and they'll not look around the room until maybe they feel more relaxed. So I think there's something to be said about how we can encourage participants maybe to have a social element before the simulation takes place to break the ice. And I know the secretariat for this year, that's something they're trying to work into the schedule. And I think that will help somewhat. And if we can convey, you know, to be, it's real life almost. So you have to see how your arguments are going down to the others in the room. It's not just you do your work and the secretariat marks you, it's ongoing feedback. I think that's so important. And I think Sabietta's comments about, you know, we don't want to dishearten people is absolutely really important. And that's why I really want to try to have some training for the secretariat about standardization and feedback, because I think it's so important that we focus on how we give positive feedback, that we never say this was really bad and that's why you've only received a score of one. It's more, this did not have such and such, and how you can improve is going forward, incorporate, and so, you know, and so on. Because I think it takes a lot, particularly from participants who, as I said earlier, may not be naturally public speakers, and that's one of the reasons maybe they want to participate, because they want to gain the confidence and gain those skills. It takes a lot to put yourself out there. And we absolutely, as a secretariat or as people facilitating the secretariat, do not want participants to feel disheartened, particularly after the first day. And I think then that idea of how we convey feedback, ensuring that it's positive feedback focused, can help address that. For me, I suppose when I had that suggestion about the ongoing feedback, I wasn't thinking of 200 words or things like that. I think more just like an idea of how we can convey something like that, this is a pass, you know, something like this is a pass, or this is something that we flagged you can consider for your next piece of work. But again, in the positive framing, because for me, I think, maybe this is just a personal opinion, but if I were to know there was something that I made a mistake on the first day and then I carried it over in the subsequent days, I would be kicking myself at the end of the week if I thought, oh, I could have changed that if I only knew. But then at the same time, that sense of looking around the room, sometimes seeing how other teams are delivering things can also influence how you shape your presentation and so on. So I think it's just such a fascinating sphere, how we evaluate and how we convey that to participants so they feel prepared. And there's so many different things that you can do to enhance that. And I just think something that charts performance so participants can identify for themselves what's working and what maybe they can consider changing. Just thinking about going into the lobbying, which many participants always panic about, and yet then they come away and say, oh, we really enjoyed that. That was so much fun. It wasn't what I expected at all. So I just think having some sort of system of letting participants know, yes, this is working, or maybe you can consider changing something, could be useful.
Yeah, I agree. We could elaborate a sort of short way of providing immediate feedback, of course positive, also in terms of you know, this what's the name, this ideogram that is used in that we used in the social media to convey approbation or appropriation, to convey the quick feeling about a statement, you know, this smiles or similar icons,
emojis,
so, yeah, something like this, you know. Because if you use words, then you know, you open the door to interpretations, maybe diverging and so on. But having a simplified way of I don't know, maybe convey the idea that you know, your performance was good on some aspects, less good on others, and so on. And this, all in all, is a mid smile or something like this. You know, and next time you will receive something different and something more. So you notice a little of improvement in the way that at least some members of the secretariat have appreciated your work, your performance. I don't know if it creates even more fuss, but it's maybe a way of providing participants, player, a tool to interpret the reactions in the room. because I understand that for some of them can be the first time they have such an experience in with the public, with an audience, speak and try to participate in such a game. So, well, I don't know. I think it's a good topic to discuss with the group.
Especially because I think we have the Moodle platform, and Moodle can allow you to, especially whenever documents have been loaded and it's categorized as like an assessment, Moodle does allow you to post a short comment, you know, underneath the file and things like that. So I just think the resource is there, and how can we utilize that in a way? And it could be exactly something that's just as simple as saying, this is a pass, you have satisfactorily completed this task, you know, just for participants to think, right, okay, that's task one down and it worked, now we go on to task two. But I also think it comes back to the point about training the secretariat, because the evaluation is so important for participants, particularly at the close of the simulation. And it's ensuring that the secretariat members who are, you know, the ones assessing the written form and the oral contributions as well, know exactly what it is that they're looking for and how to use the scale. Because I know last year, some things were marked a bit last minute, because at the end of the week, everyone on site was tired. And it basically meant then only one or two of us were left to cut the total up all the scores and things like that. And I just think having some sort of short training workshop with the secretariat about, here is how exactly you apply the criteria, that they themselves feel confident to do that. And then that can be reflected in the feedback, the level of feedback, and how it's framed, that's then given to participants. So I do really feel it's a learning experience for everyone who is involved, because last year we had members of the secretariat who had never marked anything. And this was very much a first time for them as well. So I just think as an ongoing process, it's how do we ensure the secretariat are equipped, because that obviously then has the impact on what the feedback that is given to participants will be.
I agree. It's fascinating. It's also difficult to have everybody on the same page, also among the members of the secretariat, because sometimes, you know, to written submissions, the reaction can be quite subjective. So, I mean, the key, I think, should be find a way which is encouraging always, not too open to, you know, interpretation, I mean, to diverging interpretation among even the members of the same team, because it might be that for you, pass is fine, for the other is kind of, you know, derogatory, because, you know, I don't receive any pass. I got a pass in Padova. That's a shame. So that's why icons or you know, things that do not replicate, you know, the standard wording of in the academic context can be maybe more, you know, a cautious way of dealing with the issue. Okay.
If I may, just one last comment about what Leah said, receiving a bit more explicit feedback in the end. I think that would be, as an ex-participant, I think that would be extremely useful, not only when your teamwork doesn't come out as you wished for it, or you wanted, you hoped for more, but you see that the end result wasn't the one you were aiming, but also when the result is positive, I think the feedback is crucial, because you understand what you did right, and you know how to keep doing that and replicate it in other experiences, or know how to adapt it into other academic or non-experiences. So I feel like we should really bring it forward in the next secretariat meeting and find a way how to make feedback a bit more explicit in the end of the entire process.
Okay, thank you. Thanks a lot, Leah, again, for your very clear description of all steps. I mean, it's amazing. and also to use a beta for participating, you know, actively and also engaging in our last discussion. We will convene again next week for the last series, for the last meeting of this series on Monday, not on Thursday. So 24th of July is a Monday. I won't be in Padova. I'll be in France, but hopefully with access to Wi-Fi either in the university or in my hotel. We will see. And in any case, I'll try to be present also because the topic of how to handle the trainings, this is the topic, right, is quite crucial, I think, also in the light of what we discussed today. Okay, thank you a lot. Goodbye.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Bye.
So much.
Bye-bye.
Ciao. Ciao.